Good afternoon, everybody. A warm and hello welcome from CXOTV.news, a flagship brand under TechPlus Media Group. I am Anand Sharma from TechPlus Media, your host for today's event. We have been running this webinar series titled Marketing Mondays since the lockdown started in 2019 to provide a platform to marketeers to learn from fellow marketing gurus. We have been touching on very pertinent topics related to marketing. And we have an important topic today related to marketing disaster and how we can avoid one. We all know that marketing is one of most important departments in any organization to amplify the product or service offering and build brand value of the organization. Marketing directly impacts both the P&L as well as balance sheet of organization. The valuation of a company can tank if there is a marketing goof up. A negative marketing can predict doomsday for the entire brand. Hence, it is extremely important to learn as to how to avoid a marketing disaster. And before that, let's understand how a marketing disaster happened. The key agenda items we plan to touch today are as follows. Number one, what constitutes a marketing disaster? Number two, what impacts this can have on the overall organization? Number three, how to respond after a marketing disaster has happened? Four, how to avoid a marketing disaster? And fifth, what role can technology play in this discussion? In case you want us to cover any other topic or have a question, please mention that in the Q&A section or chat panel. We have an eminent panel today. I'll request them to do a self-introduction. Going by the alphabetical order, Mehul, why don't you start first?
Hello, Anand. So thanks for inviting me for this amazing topic. And my name is Mehul Thakkar, and I take care for field marketing and brand activities for Soforce at India and SAR. Thank you.
Thanks, Mehul. Welcome on board. We have second panelist as Sindhya Bala Singh. Sindhya, why don't you introduce yourself?
Hi, I'm Sindhya. I head Global Tech Partnerships Marketing at Freshworks. Prior to that, I was working as a head of marketing in Redington. I'm a passionate tech marketer, and I love to contribute in women leadership and diversity. So as a personal interest, I'm the host of MOV Leaders, a podcast where we are celebrating women leaders. And also recently, I've been recognized as a Women Super Achiever from World Leadership Congress, as well as I have been named as the top 20 women catalyst in Indian IT. I'm looking forward to learn from all of you together. I'm also in a learning journey. Thank you, Anand, for inviting me to this panel. I'm really excited.
Thank you so much, Sindhya. Our last, but certainly not the least, third panelist is Mr. Shatrughan Yadav. Shatrughan, would you want to introduce yourself?
Thanks, Anand. Thanks for providing this opportunity. Excited to have this conversation with our fellow marketers as well as learn from the attendees as well. Hope it will be insightful for everybody. Just to give a quick introduction, I'm working with Wipro, career marketer, last 15 years throughout a technology marketer. Worked in marketing in different domains. If I talk about industry marketing, partner marketing, you know, service line marketing, thought leadership marketing, right? So I have covered the entire gamut of the marketing function, and looking forward to learn from you guys now.
Thank you so much, Shatrughan. And once again, I welcome our panelists. Friends, we know how much care and effort goes into brand building. The key arm, marketing, which amplifies the great work done by the research team or operations team, or let's say financial prudence, all assumes importance in messaging it appropriately. We have seen Nestle responding to challenge on Maggie's quality or Tanishq's intercast bridal ad. We must be better prepared to ensure that our communication is not misunderstood and must be interpreted for the intended reason. For this, we need to know how past disasters have happened, how to avoid one in the future, and is there a toolkit, again a danger word now, or business continuity planning or disaster recovery after a marketing disaster has happened. Further, can technology help in achieving this? We need not burn our own fingers, but we can always learn from others' mistakes. And that's what we intend to do today with this marquee panel. The views expressed by the speakers are their own and may not represent the viewpoint of the organization they work with. Mehul, let me start with you. So what is a marketing disaster? How would you define one? And in case you want to, you know, share more details about, are there any levels defined like we have in IT, you know, disaster levels, red, amber, green, whatever.
The disaster is defined as something which has not gone according to the plan, according to the strategy, according to the assumptions based on the research and assumptions, the data which has been collected, and any strategies which has been planned in order to execute a product launch or certain kind of growth which is expected at a company level, or even in, as a marketing, something which has been planned in terms of brand building exercise, which has not affected or touched the right segment of the people or right demographics of the people, would fall under this category of broader as a marketing disaster or basically a disaster as a whole. So I would like to categorize this into four T's. Like one is timing, right? One is a text or a theme, which is predominantly important, a communication which is important to have the right say what your brands belong to and where it has to reach in terms of B2B or B2C or in terms of masses. The third is the tradition or the culture or the region where it belongs to. And the fourth is the taste of the people which it will be catering to. So this four pillars predominantly I would say would consist of a approach or a strategy. And if something of this can go wrong, then you know what can happen. And we would like to discuss in further, right, with our case studies, references and examples, what not to do in that case. So yeah, so according to me, that was a definition of disaster.
Sure, that was great. We all know that, you know, IT disaster recovery or, you know, any disaster in network operations center or something like that is very well managed or at least prepared, right? Have you thought through or do you have any thoughts on, you know, can there be levels of disasters in marketing?
B2B, it is more of a controlled one where the audience is very, very much targeted one. But when it comes to B2C kind of brand campaigns, the levels cannot be measured in terms where you can say red, green or yellow, but it will be directly hampered to the company's growth where you wish to take your company to the next level. It may affect sometimes the position of your stocks or in the stock markets as well. And it might hamper in the country like India, which has a diverse culture. It might hamper or affect someone's feelings as well. So we cannot measure. It can be truly measured in terms of the growth the company which wants to reach at the next level, according to me. Yeah.
Sure. Thank you so much, Mehul. Hey, Sindhya, do you want to elaborate from partner's perspective as to what is a marketing disaster? What can go wrong?
See, before that, to take a step back, partnerships, there are two broad levels. One is technology partnerships, where you will co-sell along with them by positioning your solution and their solution together, especially in SaaS. It is called as apps or integration, where both the products will work together. For example, your Alexa with Google Calendar is an app, right? So two companies come together and giving a solution approach. So that is tech partnerships. On the other hand, somebody who is reselling your product, that is your channel partners. Right, so these are the two broad categories. So I'll address in both the segment. So currently I'm handling technology partnerships. Prior role, I have handled channel partnerships. So I would like to take up examples in my own experience and share it with you all. So in technology partnerships, one major thing we all need to take it in mind is while doing a campaign, you should understand whether your target audience personas are common. And are you defining your go-to marketing strategy rightly? Otherwise, what can happen is, for example, in not naming the partner, since we had a We are a help desk solution provider. We had an integration with somebody who is an incentive platform who can incentivize the support agents or employees. So we both decided that it's a great solution, and we had a lot of common installs. So we wanted to do an activity together. So both of us decided that the objective will be new audience acquisition, and we shared the cost. So we paid, and I have predicted an outcome for that activity ROI, if all of you can relate with me. So we had a certain targets based on that, and everything, we went ahead. The major disaster happened to me that time was their audience is broader HR as an audience space, because they were talking about employee experience. We were talking about like customer support head experience, right? So to have the agent productivity and so on. So our audience is a subset of their audience. So in overall, if we are targeting a lead base, mine was like 10%, 15% of the overall subset, where the cost I would have paid and the messaging I would have had in my mind is different. And similarly for a HR audience, obviously, like always, we all do a mistake. Because of the shorter time we plan, we will arrive at the topic and we will arrive at the speaker profile, and we will go again and start the promotion and discuss the content parallelly, right? This many of you can often relate with me that it will always happen. So that time only we slowly realized that, you know, my obviously the persona is different, the go-to marketing need to be different now. Our HR audience, I cannot speak to, like, you know, talking to a support head audience. And obviously, they can be an influencer, they cannot be a decision maker in this whole process. So all this realization came a little later. All I could have done is, maybe we could have had this as not a new customer acquisition journey, rather a customer education. Like how in my customer base, I could have educated about the apps, and my objective could have been, you know, app adoption or reduction in customer churn instead of acquiring a new customer. Because with this partner, I could have gone with that strategy, not with this strategy. But in initial, the realization was not there. So because we thought that partnerships is great, our solution is well resonated in the market, let's go ahead and do a partner marketing activity together, co-marketing activity together. This is a common mistake everybody does, right? Because of the short span. It is all in theory and paper. It is black and white that, you know, well, in the advance, we will have our marketing calendar fixed. We will have a strategy fixed, but always it is a moving ball. And sometimes we develop a newer relationship, we develop with a new partner, immediately we will tend to do an activity, but sometimes we'll forget the long term of it. And another angle of it, especially in tech partnerships, right? Why are we going for a solution? Because it's a monolithic, software is no more a concept, right? You have to partner with somebody else to give a solution approach to your customer. But you should always know your product roadmap also. It is always like in a lot of company, marketing and product will work silos, unfortunately, right? So their roadmap for the next 2 years, you really will not care. And you will be really, you know, next 3 quarters, maybe a product gap which your partner is fulfilling now, your own company will be ready to develop in the cards. Without realizing that, you will hardly investing every money, penny, resource, time, and develop that partnership and grow up to a scale. And suddenly you will realize that your own company is launching that feature, and you will, you know, they will become your competitor. So in this whole arena, your partnership is also going for a toss. Your you know, whole strategy, time, energy, resource, everything goes for a toss, right? So this all blind spots, right? Sometimes in partnership marketing, you will only think of the company messaging and this thing. You will really not get into the product roadmaps, what they are doing it for the next 4 quarters, 5 quarters, something they will tend to miss. It will all look like how can they miss? But unfortunately, those blind spots spots will be there for sure. This is on the technology partnership, the two major disasters which you should avoid. On a channel partnership perspective, unfortunately, brand always have a problem in pushing the channel partners to do what they wanted to do. And sometimes we will forget in the whole journey that, you know, what the partner is strong. Certain partners will be strong in SMB space, and they will be, their sweet spot is SMB space, but your target will be on mid-market. And you will force them to, you know, do a campaign on mid-market, and you will fund them, and you will expect them to deliver. So even in sometimes, definitely most of the times, delivery will not happen. But in sometimes, when they deliver also, they will not be able to close, because their capability, implementation, and whatever it is, that will not be there in the mid-market level. Even when they generate leads through some third party agency or something with the money or MDF you provide for you to achieve your target, but the end result, the revenue may not happen, or it will end up in a bad customer experience for you also because your partner is not able to go and appear as a mid market person. So you should first understand where your channel partner sweet spot is, how you wanted to develop with them, how you have to jointly plan. So from the both technology partners and channel partners, first you need to understand and give first for any partnership that is important, and understand, build slowly, and then start expecting. This is sometimes we will force our targets to our partners, and we will also come under pressure. We will pressurize our partners also. Partnership is a relationship game. In the whole disaster thing, not only your targets and ROI will go for a toss, the long-term partnership and your name in the ecosystem also will go for a toss.
Absolutely. Understood. Sure. No, makes sense. You have made me thinking. Okay. Coming to Shatrughan. Shatrughan, you are coming from a large organization. How do you see a marketing disaster, in a large organization perspective, and what would be its impact?
You said it rightly. For a large organization, sometimes it can be more disastrous, right? Because there are different teams who are working. So an integrated message and the timing is very, very critical so that everybody speaks the same language, right? And I think Mehul touched upon the B2B and B2C, right? So the masses targeted individuals, right? So we end up working with, like, say, 1,000 customers who are our premium customers, right? So I think we need to control that particular part very, very clearly, right? And make sure that we are taking care of them and rest falls in place, right? And the other part which Cynthia was talking about from a partner marketing standpoint, because we work with, specifically from IT service companies, we end up working with, I can just talk about just to a minimum subsidies around 100 partners, right? Today, if you see the technology stack, right, image is just huge, right? Starting from application partners, analytics partners, right, infrastructure partners, and cloud, right? And everybody is working along with the each other, right? So getting the entire team working together, formed our own organization, right? Then catering that message to respective industries, and then getting the entire ecosystem, which is our technology partners, our cloud partners, and I can talk about our venture partners and industry partners, right? Getting the entire ecosystem working together and then go to market with a common message is something we really need to think through, right? Now, what happens is it all depends, right? And it is always not a perfect recipe, right? It all depends, how you are planning and what you want to achieve, right? Keeping customer at the center, right? So I think in my view, customer is the center point and around which everybody everything revolves, right? And all depends what you want to achieve out of the campaign or a marketing program, right? I normally divide these, and I'll just talk about a little bit planning aspect, right? Because this is very critical, and sometimes we end up going wrong on that part, but we all know that, right? But it all, as you said, right, it's a crowded market, it's a playing field. Just think about a situation I keep telling my team members, as well as wherever I have spoken to the upcoming marketers, MBA graduates, right? So if it's like a playing field where it's not like two football teams, we are competing with each other, right? Just think about a scenario where you have some, in a field, you have three or four football teams playing, right? Then you need to see how you'll partner and how you'll be able to get the message out and how you'll be able to get the strategy out, right? Now, coming back to the point, right, what do you want to achieve out of the campaign that's very, very critical, or a program, right? I normally look at three aspects, which is reputation, our relationship, and revenue, right? And these three impacts make a lot of difference and depend upon the program to program, right? So if I talk about, let's say, a partner marketing campaign or a program, right, I think the aspect will be relationship and revenue. Because as Cynthia was talking about, partnerships are critical. So we need to make sure that we are relevant to the partner. And revenue is important because we want to get the joint program out so that it benefits both everybody, right? But if I talk about a marketing program which I'm catering to my customers, right, then my reputation and referenceability plays a key role. And that gives me the long-term benefit because, as I said, right, it's not like a B2C company where the impact is just huge in like a 10-day time span, right? In IT organizations, right, the deal cycles are big, right? It takes time and the impact goes slowly. But it's a very big impact when it comes to, right? So it all depends how you plan with keeping the end objective in mind, right? And then comes the respective cycle. And normally in a B2B environment, everything is thought leadership driven, right? It's all about your messaging or content, to summarize, right? So how you cater to the content to conversion cycle. So when I talk about content to conversion cycle, means how you're creating the content, right? Whether it is relevant to the audience or the customer or to the respective market, right? As Mehul was talking about, it's the timing, right? And the timing of the content is right. Just to give an example, in COVID time, right? Our messaging should be different, it's empathy led, right? Whereas in other timings, we are just bombarding with the respective messages, right? With whatever we want to take it to market. But here we want to be sensitive about the target market and campaign we're creating, right? So content creation, content packaging, right? And then getting it to the customer so that we can engage and create conversations, right? So content creation to content conversations is one cycle, and content conversations to conversion is another cycle, right? And you need to have different programs to cater to your customers, right? And that's where, at the same point, in a B2B environment, sales and marketing alignment is very critical. So I can do a campaign, I'm ready with a good message, right? But I don't know who is my customer. I may have the customer list also, but I don't know in which cycle the deals are going on right now, right? So I need to do a funnel analysis in terms of where we are seeing, let's say if I talk about cloud or if I talk about analytics, right? Out of the funnel, how many customers today are actually engaged with us around this, right? And how much potential we have. So as I said, right, on a B2B environment, your customer set is comparatively narrower, right? So you know how much penetration you have. So all the programs should be keeping in mind while talking about it. Now coming back to the technology part, which we can discuss, but I think these are the aspects which we should keep in mind while planning a marketing program. And of course, we can then talk about whether it was a disaster or not, because ultimately it's a very, very short window.
Sure. Mehul, let me ask a tough question to you. How would you respond to a marketing disaster?
First of all, I'll just share an example. What can be a classic case of a marketing disaster, and then we can see how we can respond and what are the back-off plans for the same. Mm-hmm. Just imagine India with so much diversity, so much cultural, so much festivals around it. And just one example where we are planning a campaign, or where we are planning we participate in Tech Plus event, right? For example, for CXO. And just imagine if one part of India is working, and another part of India is holiday, and the third part of India or rest of India has an optional holiday. So we just recently came to the situation that we don't know, like everything, all the technology was in place, all the content was in place, the timing, we don't know, right? So this is a classic case of, and this is not the history or the FMCG or the product scenario. This is a classic case of technology where we are marketing into our channels, where we are marketing into our end users with the lieu of a technology. Everything was so placed with the new modern tools available, and we cannot control anything, right? Because of such a timing or such a situation where we cannot have this one. So even this is just an example, but how to control is equally very, very equivalent or relevant in today's scenario. With all the handy tools, all the marketing automation tools, all the analytics, all the marketing intelligence over the delegates or the attendees which are available. So I think the backup plan in this scenario is very, very critical. And thanks to this virtual world or the digital world, the tools which are available makes us very, very easy for the backup options, right? So for example, if we are missing out on the timing, then we always can have a recording version of it, right? So for example, if people are attending may miss this session or may miss this webinar, but thanks to technology, they will still able to attend this over a period of the next 90 days or next 100 days, which was not the case earlier when we were living in a normal. And so I think thanks to the new normal where we are learning best of both the things, right? The traditional approach and the modern day virtual approach through a mix of technology and some great brains behind them. So to have our messaging convey not only for that particular day, maybe a cocktail event, but at least for next 100 days or maybe next 365 days. And so I think the marketing, the recovery to that disaster now in today's world or in our IT scenario has been minimized to a certain extent when looking at the overall aspect of the same. So yeah, that was my response to your question.
No, thank you, appreciate it. Sindhya, any major marketing disaster you have come across and how do you address them?
Okay, it may look pretty generic for most of you, but you all will relate this disaster with me. It's always a sales and marketing misalignment. It's the major disaster, which will make you to lose a lot of revenue. There is a study which states that $1 trillion of revenue is getting lost because of sales and marketing misalignment. And on the contrary, if your sales and marketing is aligned properly, there is a high possibility that year on year you will grow by 208%. This is a proven fact. So to dig deep into this, Freshworks is a very growing company. You all know Unicom. We are growing in multifold, so we definitely need a strong sales and marketing alignment to best bring the best ROI out of it. And we also have our own CRM. So on account of all these things, we launched a massive survey for 1,200 respondents of C-level contacts, VP and directors. This survey thrown out pretty good insights. Like overall, it has come out like fragmented customer data causes the major issues. And 90% agrees that sales and marketing alignment is important for their revenue. But only 44% believes, it is only belief, it is not reality. They are aligned with their sales team rightly. And similarly, the popular demand of marketing is that they wanted to have the view on the bottom of the funnel activities. And the sales popular view is they wanted to see the have the view of the top of the funnel activities of marketing does. So overall, the customer journey is the second most abused word in between sales and marketing, right? But only 33% believes that they have the complete 360 degree view of the customer data. So this comes to a fact that how important sales and marketing alignment need to be done for us also. There are a lot of times we drown on leads, especially on a personal side, right? When you go completely digital, you will not have a shortage of leads, right? So much of leads and contacts will flow. And me as a marketing person, I'll always feel that, 2,000 leads I have delivered, but only 20 you converted, sales is not working properly. And the sales will come and say, hey, Sindhya, all 2,000 leads are buckwurst. There is nothing. It's all low quality leads. And 20 itself, with a great effort, I have converted. So it'll be like what call you have spoken, what script you have spoken. So up and down, right? And we realize it is important to segregate between low intent leads and high intent leads in a technical way. It cannot be a subjectual way. It's a technical way. You need to bifurcate between low intent and high intent, so that high intent leads can be concentrated by your SDRs or sales team to convert into pipeline and closure, so that will shorten your sales cycle. On the other hand, marketing has to concentrate on nurturing this low intent leads to move that to high intent leads. Instead of, we have another habit, right? I have this personal experience. We'll do one campaign, pass to sales, move on to next campaign. We'll not really bother that the drop of the leads, which is not getting converted, will not even care about that. So nurture plays an important role. It's not only about mailing, right? That itself is a separate topic. But in the overall thing, how will you bridge this? You need to have a proper lead qualification system. So this is something how we responded. So to have this proper lead qualification in place, I will give you the 5 easy tips which we followed. The first step is lead scoring, which is very, very important. How often your customer is or prospect is interacting with your web content or web form or your activity, and you need to have a lead scoring defined basis on that engagement and fit, right? So basis on your engagement and fit, when a certain lead score gets passed, only you have to pass that to your sales team. Then only that prospect is ready to be contacted. Before that, they cannot be contacted. you need to make them to engage to the more number of content or activities or the your web content before you pass the lead to your sales team. So lead scoring plays a major role. Second comes the basic rule: do your homework rightly, right? Even as an SDR or somebody, when you are reaching to your prospect, instead of asking like number I have to have or which email ID I have to have, you can go to their LinkedIn, find their details, and instead of that, I have this email ID. Can I contact with this, or do you prefer in some other mode? I have seen often you have downloaded this white paper or interacted with this content. So can I presume that you are going through solve this problem? So can you have enough details well in advance before talking to them? Because there is only 30% of prospects feel they get what they wanted in the first discovery call. Because the third important step is band qualification. It's again a most abused word, right? Budget, lead, authority, decision maker. Again, it will be a one-way street. Like I have to have this budget. Instead of directly asking a prospect what is your budget, most of the people will not be comfortable. So there you have to communicate in a way that your budget, are you fitting into the timelines? You have to evaluate without them thinking that you are taking too much of information from them. Rather, they have to have a feeling that they are learning in their first call. So to have a killer discovery call is something very, very important. For that, you need to have your homework and lead scoring in place. So always in band, in short, we will say a spin approach. So yes, is something like you need to communicate the situation they are into. For example, if I'm pitching a CRM, so like how are you managing your sales lead currently? You need to make them understand their situation first. That is S, right? And then what problem they are into. Are you having enough high intent leads, capturing into your system? Will be you are making them to realizing the problem. Third is impact. Need to communicate like, oh, you have a huge revenue target. How will you cope up with such low intent leads coming inside? How will you increase your high intent leads? So make them realize the impact. And then finally, you need to communicate them on the solution part, right? You have to have a solution for this. So like implementing this, obviously your high intent leads will go up this much percentage, always talk in statistics so that you can close in this much shorter term, you can save this much of cost. So this approach, spin approach, is very, very important to have a shorter sales pitch, right? And for that, marketing needs to be aligned in a way to differentiate that high intent leads, do a proper lead scoring, get their qualification brought right, and get their enrichment of data field right. See, today, anybody can pick up, right? Today, Mehul can go and speak to a customer and he will have a personal emergency. Tomorrow, I'm coming into picture. I cannot ask all the questions again. Today also with the ACT, I wanted to register a complaint to get a faster bandwidth. Every time they asked me which router you are using, I got so pissed off today and I said, like, how many times you wanted to tell this again and again? So a lot of times we will have a proper qualification methodology, but are we recording it right? So today somebody is not there, your pipeline is moving seamlessly. You cannot expect the prospect to come, wait till you finish your first emergency to come. Your colleague need to pick up from where they left without making the transition feel for the customer. So how technology is important for this? So definitely we from our experience at least understood working on a unified platform as a technology between sales and marketing is important. That will definitely affect your revenue growth, customer experience, and job retention. This is how we realized, how marketing disaster or any disaster, it's not even marketing, it's a company disaster between sales and marketing. This is how we responded, Anand.
Sure. No, it was quite informative, and you gave lots of pointers to take forward. So thank you so much, Sandhya. We could see the passion in the response. So I have some follow-up questions, if time permits, we'll ask towards the end. So moving on to my next one, Shitugan, I have also worked in large organizations, so I can relate. We generally tend to have SOP for everything, okay? So should we have an SOP on marketing disaster recovery? And if yes or if no, there could be reasons behind it. What should it constitute?
I think it's yes and no, but definitely a SOP is required, right? What we normally do is, and what I've seen as part of my role, I interact with, I think, as I said, like 30 to 40 partners, right? And there are best practices with each company. So, for example, if I just to take an example about Microsoft or a Google or a Amazon, on the other side, if I talk about infrastructure vendors like HP and Cisco, or smaller partners which are just coming up, right, who are actually learning, there is a lot to learn in terms of how they go to market, right? So we take best practices from each, right, and put together a series of checklists, right? I'll not say that it's like everybody need to be particular about what need to follow, because as I said, every campaign, every marketing program is different, and there is a different customization, and we need to make it contextual, right? So just talk about two or three things, right? I think very, very critical that whether and I'll talk about certain examples, right? As part of IT organization, we end up in participating in many of the analyst ranking firms, right? And today we have Gartners and IDCs and Foresters and HFS and everybody, right? And just think about, we have like cloud, we have analytics, we have CRM, we have SAP, we have Oracle, we have Salesforce, you know, every technology report that there is there, right? If I talk about quarterly or an overall level, I mean, again, I'm not just want to reveal on a high level, I'm giving a rough estimate. Let's say if I'm talking about 100 reports, right, it becomes very, very difficult to respond to every report, because it also not only involving the marketing function, but also involving the business function and the sales team, right? Because you end up in having customer endorsements, right? So the point I'm going to make is we evaluate that report based on a particular checklist. Point number one is whether we have the right engagement with the analyst. Is the analyst aware of what Wipro is or what Wipro is doing in this area? Or let's say, for example, for that particular area, is he aware? It means have we engaged with the analyst proactively, right? So that later on it will help. Otherwise, he will say, I understand, but I couldn't relate to what you guys have put together as part of response, right? Point number one. Point number two, do we believe in that particular area we have enough customers, right? Point number three, do we have enough time to respond to this RFP, right? And point number four, the customer references, what are the timing? Because in certain cases, you will require the customer to come on a call. In certain cases, you want the customer to come do an email response, right? And now, for example, in COVID, right, we have actually gone back to analysts saying that, guys, we can't give you customer references because this is not the time customers come and speak about it, right? So they're okay with email responses. In fact, they were okay with sharing some website endorsements or customer testimonials which are there available, right? So there are situations like that. The point I'm trying to make is we have this process, right? And then we take a call whether we want to participate in that report. But what happens is, in certain situations, the report comes and this is a new report, and we need to be participating in that. In case you are not there, then you are not in the market, right? And my sales guy will come and say, guys, I was not in this report, and that is the reason I didn't get invited for the RFP itself, right? And one statement is good enough, right? And many people do come back with us. Of course, marketing just gives that sometimes. But the point I'm trying to make is that's the reality, right? We need to understand what the sales guy is going through. So we take a call on that also. So yes, just to answer your question, I just try to explain with this example. We need to have an SOP in place, but it is contextual. And in certain situations, we do take exceptions. Having said that, most of the marketing disasters, in my view, can be avoided if you say no and if the right timing and planning is not in place. Otherwise, we face long-term ROI issues as a marketing team. That's what my
absolutely with you. Absolutely. So the whole purpose or thought process behind choosing this topic was to ensure that if or once a marketing disaster happen, the teams should not be running helter-skelter to address it, right? So there should be very crisp, clear, laid out processes that, hey, let's do this, let's do that, step number one, step number two, step number three, so on and so forth. I totally agree with you that it has to be very contextual, but that's what it has to be, right? So if a miscommunication has happened, it has to be addressed in this manner. If a branding issue has happened, or if a quality compromise has happened, how it has to be managed, right? So, well, we can go on, but let me just try to cover the do justice to the topics or items that I had listed out. So Mehul, moving on to you, what specific steps to be taken to avoid a marketing disaster altogether?
So basically, any we all have learned the Murphy's law, right? Anything which has needs to be going wrong, it will go wrong. But I think in today's world, with so many backups, so much data which is available, so much marketing tools available, so much automation and artificial intelligence data which is available, I think the error of going wrong has decreased. And in the scenario where we are belong to a technological vertical or technology industry, where we ourselves are implementing those tools, processes, SOPs, and then designing a campaign, designing some of the content which is either marketed to partners or partner-driven or end users. So I think the technology has come up a long, long way. And thanks to COVID as well, we have started thinking out of the box. Who has a great example is like Marketing Mondays, right? Who has thought about a marketing seminar or session conducted in a closed room within a Monday afternoon and discussing on some great subjects and topic? So I think we have come out a long way. Our abilities has gone beyond. The company processes and even the LT or the SMT members has supported a long way, especially to marketing and the IT professionals working day in and day out, like the COVID warriors. I am sure we are also making a great effort to reach out our messaging, our communication in a much more user-friendly, better way. And I think, including you or including any of the third party who are conducting such kind of various platform events, right, has come out a long way. And even the customers have understood, like, where we are approaching, where we are marketing, where we are communicating. They have also understood the need of an hour. They have also supported a long way. And I think it's a win-win situation for all of us. And I think one thing, like, going forward, when the new normal is over and when we are coming to back to a normal days, I think the new strategy which will be formed will be mix of both the worlds. The traditional worlds and the new modern day approach will surely be integrated to form our future marketing activities and budgets as well, including strategies.
So, Cynthia, any thoughts on this, how to avoid a marketing disaster?
On a partner perspective, as I touched upon already, certain basics has to be kept rightly. For instance, if channel partnership level, why are you recruiting your partners, right? You need to have your recruitment strategy right for which objective you are recruiting, and you need to identify and recruit the right partners. That is very, very important. And second, you need to make your selling easy for them. By giving them your overall objective, your company mission, what you're trying to achieve, how to pitch your product to various level of industry, segments, all your collaterals should be very well. The sales enablement should be done very well for them to act as your extended arm. And similarly, marketing campaigns, right? Make them to use as your own. They should act as your marketer. Instead of you behaving like, hey, I'll tell what to do, you have to go and execute, that will not work. Rather, you have to enable them and tell them this is what we are jointly trying to achieve, and come up with your own plan, and you have to support them with your inputs, marketing campaign messaging for them to readily adapt and use. That is something, drawing out the joint messaging or go-to marketing strategy together is very, very important at each partner level. You cannot have a generic approach here. You have to have partner level approach here. And on a technology partnership side, I would say even more important to work closely with your product team and understand for your customers what kind of technology partners you have to go deep with. And then start with them on the go-to marketing messaging, coming up with a joint value proposition document, enabling both the sales team and marketing teams, come up with the demo video of the integration, educating your customer and their customer before jointly go and acquiring new customers or new prospects for both of you. So that has to be a long-term strategy, may not immediately go for leads. You have to do a lot of content work around on the technology partnerships to keep your blogs, sales enablement, collateral, joint marketing, messaging, integration messaging right, and then go and do your audience acquisition strategy and audience retention, or customer retention strategy. So So this is the important steps for you to avoid the disaster happening, and the goals should be shared and common instead of one way. And always in a partnership, you should start giving and build the trust that will help you in the long term game of achieving together. They should feel as a single entity instead of questioning each other. It should be like working together as a team towards a common objective. This is very important.
Cool. Thank you so much, Sandhya. Moving on to perhaps my last question, Shatrughna, what role can technology play in both responding to as well as avoiding a marketing disaster?
If we need to get this right from here, our system should be so proactive in analyzing and giving us that response, right, or the analytics that something is going to happen, and I should be able to take action on that. Just to give an example, if I am handling a customer experience department, right, and we have these systems where through the tone of the customer who's speaking, right, we can analyze whether the customer was happy or not, right? It just shows on the screen, right? Your customer representative cannot bluff, right? Because the system is actually controlling the sentiment, what the customer is talking, right? The tone of the voice, right? What he's speaking, the words he's using. From speech to text, right? What is speaking actually getting captured as a text also, right? So just think about a situation, and we have those solutions which we are implementing for our customers, and seen ultimately it's a marketing or marketing stack, right, that comes into play from a call center standpoint, right, or a contact center experience, right? So this is just an example. So it's very, very critical, and this technology can help you do that, right? Second is, I think there are many fake platforms or fake accounts or fake people or ideas getting created who are actually somewhere damaging your brand, right? I think your system should, or your website, or you should have systems in place to identify those, which will help you to sort of get the right messages and try to avoid and filter them out, right? That's the second point, right? Third point, which I believe, and which is very critical, security is key. It's a board level topic, right? So all these security systems, specifically when you're running a program, we should get a report every day. And in case an attack has happened, as a marketing team, right, should be able to let the organization know. First is our internal customers, is our own organization. Second, the system should be designed such that if something has happened, we should be the first to tell our customers so that he don't hear from anybody else, but hear from us. That's why the system should be that much intelligent, right? That helps, right? Because then your competition will not able to sort of have a attacking strategy in terms of, hey guys, this is where, you know, XYZ company is not doing well, or they have XYZ issues, but you know, we have this. Of course, everybody will try to do that, right? There is a competition attack strategy which goes with respect to accounts in case something goes wrong, right? Apart from that, right, I think very important point is when something happens, right, or a disaster happens, right, first thing, again, the person will come on your website or the respective app, right? Your app or the website should be intelligent enough to understand that students or customers are coming, right? In that scenario, there should be a stack of positive information which is available with you guys, and automatically should get reflecting, which can be a blog, also it can be a response, right, which should be immediately available, and the website should start throwing those, right? So just sort of subdue the environment which was there, right? So I think that's again comes back to the technology system, right? I think these are three or four examples which I want to highlight, right? Of course, continuous tracking and all those things everybody do, but I think these can help us to sort of manage our recovery better. Last but very, very important, which I think we often ignore, is the training part. As I said, right, this can be a monthly report, it can be a weekly report, depending on the damage. But having said that, your marketing team or the respective teams who are engaging with your website team, and these will be a partner team sometimes, right? Because there are Adobe Experience Manager, and you have analytics, and you have Power BI, right? So many vendors will be coming together to deliver the experience what you want for customers. We need to make sure that we get the training right for them, so that we control if something goes wrong faster. Fast is important. So I think that's from my side on this. So technology is very, very good.
No, very nice. Thank you so much, Shatrughna. That was absolutely fantastic. Mehul, any we are wrapping up. So any parting thoughts for the audience?
So I think as we are wrapping up, the technology in today's scenario and disaster management goes hand in hand. So I think having the right technology with right set of people and right set of training, what to adopt where, if we have that basic sense of where we want to and where we are going, I think that will really help us to shorten that error of disaster. And with the technology, as Shatrughan mentioned, we have so much backup tools nowadays available, so that the reporting of the issue or the backup plan which we want to take it up has given us the variety of options, and we can have a suitable response, whether to our partner, whether to our customer, in case of disaster which has happened in the world of technology. So yeah, looking forward. Thank you.
Sure. Sindhya, any last comments?
To avoid a disaster, the thumb rule or the mantra to go about is having an internal alignment between your sales team, marketing team, and support team, because even that is important, right? Because your customer need to turn as an advocate. Otherwise, whatever efforts you are doing, it will all go for this. So these three, along with the product, need to be in sync, and they need to have a common objective. And it is often like due to multiple teams, right? You will have a central marketing team, field marketing team, customer marketing team, partner marketing team, you will tend all to use the same medium, same persona, different messaging. So that has to be avoided. Between teams, a big integrated campaign need to be built. The messaging need to be common. The medium has to be not cannibalized with each other. And similar on a partner perspective, one additional level has to be taken care of, that you're not cannibalizing with your partner, rather you are complementing each other with the partners too. So for partners, an extra step of aligning to the external world is also important. But on a broader perspective, to resonate with the audience, it's very, very important to have a common alignment between the teams and know which medium you're going after and how not to cannibalize the medium and how not to consume, confuse or consume your audience or prospect with multiple messaging without having a common objective.
Thank you so much, Sindhya. That was fantastic. So guys, we are on top of the hour. Okay, we had this wonderful discussion wherein Mehul talked about 4 T's: timing, theme, tradition, and taste. Shatrughan touched upon content creation to conversation to conversion. And Sindhya covered from both tech partner as well as business partner perspective. Okay. Then recovery to disaster cycle has been shortened now thanks to technology. And then we also touched upon low intent versus high intent leads, and then marketing must nurture low intent to high intent leads. A lot of discussion points. My notebook is almost full now. I'm confident that you have enjoyed this enriching session as much as I did. Moreover, it's always beneficial to hear from the leaders directly. You can watch the past webinars on cxotv.news. I thank each one of you for taking out time and attending this event, and wish you all the success during these challenging times. With this, we call it a day. Once again, thanking our panelists, and thanks once again for your esteemed presence, and wish you a great week ahead.
For more updates from CXO TV, please like and subscribe to our channel.